Bites. Sassy girl, sassy. Get feminine. Don't just go. All dances come from the music. Whatever music is being played, that's the way that you try to dance.
Very cool.
When you Lindy Hopping, you swinging, honey. I mean, you swinging, baby. Lindy Hopper, darling, and I swing.
Frankie Manning started swinging back when swing music was born in the early 1930s.
New York was a very lively town back then. There were clubs on practically every corner, in Harlem particularly. So the people from downtown would come uptown to be entertained by some of the best entertainers in the world.
Frankie was raised in Harlem by a single mother. He learned to dance in the great Harlem ballrooms, the Alhambra, the Renaissance, and the best of them all, the Savoy.
When I walked into the Savoy Ballroom and I saw those dancers up there, I said, I can't dance. Because those guys at the Savoy Ballroom was cutting the rug, Jim. You know, I mean, they were really swinging up there.
The crowd there was wild about a new dance, the Lindy Hop. A variation on the Charleston, the Lindy was named in honor of Charles Lindbergh's hop across the Atlantic in 1927. At the Savoy, it was danced to the sounds of first-class bands.
That music just made you feel like you wanted to move with it, you know.
The first time I went there, I thought I was in heaven. The doors opened and the music was blessing.
Ruthie Rheingold was a teenager when she started going to the Savoy in the early 1930s. It was the first major club in Harlem to allow blacks and whites on the same dance floor.
It was a great place, you know, for a quarter. You had a nice pleasure. I don't have to tell you about the music. And
Well, tell me about the music.
Oh my God. How can you tell about music? Mainly Count Basie. There were times I was so tired, I thought, oh my God, I have to go home. And then another song would come out, and I'd say, oh, I love that song, and I was back on the floor again.
The dancers doing the latest steps and the fanciest footwork danced at the north end of the ballroom, known as Cat's Corner. Dancers like Frankie, who wanted to improve their skills, watched the moves closely.
We were learning like that by stealing from these other, from the more advanced dancers.
By the time he turned 20, Frankie was spending much of his time at the Savoy. He had dropped out of high school a few years earlier.
I didn't really have an incentive. I don't think they encouraged any of the African Americans at that time to, you know, to be real professional people. I didn't know what I wanted to be.
At 18, Frankie had fathered a baby boy, but he admits he wasn't ready for the responsibility.
I don't think I was much of a much of a father because I didn't see him that much. I would see him occasionally, but you know, I didn't really raise him. His mother did.
Frankie Manning was looking for direction on the dance floor of the Savoy Ballroom. He found it when he met a father figure of his own, Herbert Whitey White.
Everybody knew Whitey, you know, because he had a white streak in his hair, you know. And we would always see him walk around the ballroom, and we knew why.
He said he had a good eye for talent. That was just a great, great honor to be one of his dancers.
If, you know, we see him walking by or something like that, we try to put on something a little extra, you know, to see if he would notice.
It took a few months, but Whitey did notice the lanky teenager with quick feet and a huge smile.
He stopped and called me over, and he said, I think you got the makings of a pretty good dancer. How would you like to meet some of the better dancers on the other side?
Frankie got Whitey's blessing to join the best of the best in Cat's Corner, like George Shorty Snowden.
Shorty Snowden was my idol, and anything he did, I'll try to imitate. He was about 5 feet two, and he had a partner, Big B, they call her. And she was about 6 feet two, so she loomed over him, you know. She would like pick Shorty up on her back and walk off the floor with him. We call it a lift. It was humorous seeing this little guy on the back of this big girl kicking his feet up and down.
Within weeks, Frankie could mimic George's steps. Soon, he was inventing moves of his own.
Sometimes you just hear a riff in music, you know, like something might say, jung, bum, 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 bum. And you just try to, okay, what does that sound like? Jung, bum, 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 bum. And that music is saying to you, hey, do this, man.
Did you think of yourself as a choreographer?
Oh, no. No, I didn't think of myself as a choreographer or anything like that. I just danced.
Inspired by Shorty George's famous lift, Frankie approached a dance partner with an idea.
I want to pick you up on my back, and I want you to roll over my back. To be like a step, a continuous movement, where you get on the back and you keep rolling and come down in front of me.
It was the first of many aerial moves. He called them air steps that would become Frankie's trademark. Frankie and the other young dancers from Cat's Corner, now known as Whitey's Lindy Hoppers or Whitey's Hoppin' Maniacs, started getting gigs up and down the Eastern Seaboard. And at the hottest venues back home.
This program is coming to you from the Cotton Club in Harlem, New York City. Now, Cab Calloway, the Prince of Hidey-Ho, will entertain you with some hotshaw razzmatazz.
How big a deal was it to dance at the Cotton Club?
Whoa, are you kidding? Only the best in the entertainment world worked at the Cotton Club. Cab Calloway, Duke Ellington, and to work with these people in the same show with them, oh man.
The bands may have had the big names, but it was the dancers with their lightning-fast acrobatic style that electrified audiences wherever they went.
Wild, fantastic girls being thrown everywhere. It was just the most exciting thing that I had ever seen.
Frankie's son, Chaz Young, first saw his father perform when Chaz was a child.
My dad was very strong, and he had them girls sailing further than the other fella. So that's what I remember very, very well.
But Chaz has few memories from that era. Now, Frankie off the stage.
I didn't get chance to see him as often as I would have liked to, but I always knew when he was in town. And I would go see the show, of course, and I would go backstage and hang out backstage and with him. they stayed on the road a lot because they were that good. Yes, I mean, I did miss him, but I knew what he was doing.
Even as Frankie became a celebrity uptown, there were still doors that were closed to him and the other Lindy Hoppers because they were black. He remembers a night in the 1930s when he and a group of dancing buddies went to see a big band show at the Roseland Ballroom in Midtown Manhattan.
When we got down there to go in, the guy wouldn't let us in, you know, so he said, well, you can't come in. And I'm kind of hard skin, you know, like a tough skin, I should say. And it just rubbed off my back.
On tour, things were worse. Many of the clubs that profited from the group's performances wouldn't let them in as customers. After the Lindy Hoppers did a knockout opening number for Billie Holiday and the Count Basie Orchestra at a Boston hotel, they sat down to watch the rest of the show.
One of the waiters came over and told us we couldn't sit there, you know. So we went on back to our room.
When they told Holiday what had happened, she went and talked to the hotel management.
She said, well, if these kids can't come out and hear me sing, then I'm not going to sing anymore. Eventually, the management said, well, okay, we'll set up a table for them to sit at, you know. Ordinarily, you know, we might not have gone out like every show to hear us sing. But since they didn't want us out there, we said, well, we're going to be there. So we've been out every night and just sat at the table and listened to us sing.
It's on, baby. It has turned off and gone.
Frankie was determined to push past the bigotry. He made white friends, including a couple of spectacular dancers he met at Cat's Corner at the Savoy, Harry Rosenberg and Ruthie Rheingold.
Whitey approached us and asked, would we like to dance, be one of his dancers, and of course that was the greatest honor. What could be better? And especially that we were white.
These two Jewish kids from the Bronx were the only white couple ever to dance in the premier swing group in Harlem.
How good a dancer were you?
Pretty good. Pretty good. I had to be one of Whitey's.
The nightclub audiences, mostly white, were sometimes taken aback that Harry and Ruthie were part of the troupe.
While we were dancing, we could hear the people saying, they're white, they're white. They were screaming. I don't know because we were good or because we were white, but they were in shock.
The official photos and film footage of Whitey's Lindy Hoppers don't include Harry and Ruthie. Blacks and whites dancing in the same group was just too controversial.
What did your parents think that you were going to?
My father didn't know. Oh, my God. My mother was very unhappy. Very unhappy.
But to the dancers and Whitey's Lindy Hoppers, Ruthie and Frankie say, race just wasn't an issue.
We didn't know black and white. We knew dancing. So we didn't look at somebody and say, oh, that's a person that is a different color than you. We just looked at his feet and said, can you move them feet?
That's right.
And as long
That's
as you
right.
can move your feet, color
didn't matter.
Let me tell you something. This young lady was a swinger, Jim. She could dance. I'll tell you. She could dance.
I loved it.
She used to have the little twist. She
just, yeah, right,
Ruthie says Frankie was the real superstar.
Of all of us, he was the best. Very graceful, very good, wonderful smile, great dancer, great. And choreographer, very talented guy.
Frankie Manning's talents took him from Harlem to the great cities of Europe.
Being in Paris for the first time, my very first European trip, and I'm landing in Paris at the Moulin Rouge. That was fantastic, man.
There was one stop for entertainers even bigger than Paris, Hollywood. Frankie and his fellow Lindy Hoppers danced in major motion pictures like Hot Chocolate and Hell's a Poppin'. Released in 1941, Hell's a Poppin' featured a 2.5-minute dance sequence, choreographed by Frankie Manning.
I'm mistaken. Here comes something now.
I wanted it to really be a swinging thing, and I wanted everybody to know what they were doing and when they were supposed to do it. They gave us a certain amount of space to dance because the cameras have to be set up at different spots. It was pretty hard, you know, like trying to stay in a small space, and we were just moving all over the place, you know. The routines were pretty tough, but because all of them had, you know, difficult air steps and or comedy air steps. Anne was like a cat. Her feet would be flying all over, but when she lands, she would land, shoom, you know, like solid. We practiced so often till we got an opportunity to actually communicate with each other without speaking, just with body movements or what we were doing.
It's just one of the most exciting routines that I've ever seen in my life. When he would grab the girl and pull the girl toward him, and she's up in the air, and he catches her on the shoulder, that was a showstopper as far as I'm concerned, because you think that she is gonna go flying past him, but she lands on his shoulder. That's a spectacular a stunt, and it's called the snatch.
Frankie's son, Chaz, was just 9 years old when Hell's a Poppin' came out, but seeing his dad on the big screen sparked his own interest in dance.
So I just started to practice and practice when I wasn't in class, because I wanted to be good. I wanted to be very good.
Swing dancing great Norman Miller, one of Frankie's closest friends, hired Chaz as a teenager to be in her dance troupe. He says he performed best when his father was in the audience.
I just wanted to tear up the stage. I wanted to be super good. I said to myself, well, this show is for you, Dad.
By the time Chaz's career took off, Frankie was dancing less. He'd been drafted into the U.S. Army in 1943, the height of World War II. He fought in the jungles of New Guinea.
I met a lot of other guys over there that, you know, we became friends, and I saw some of them, you know, like dying right alongside of me. And well, sometimes now I think about that, and I don't want to think about it.
After the war, Frankie danced for a few more years, but by the 1950s, the era of swing was fading. Lindy hopping was no longer a way to make a living. Frankie got a job at the post office. He got married and had a daughter and another son. Eventually, he divorced. He stayed with the post office for 30 years. An ordinary life, Frankie says, and a good one. He didn't tell his colleagues much about his years as an entertainer.
They knew that I had been in show business, but I didn't expound on that. I didn't say, well, yeah, I did this, I did that, and all.
So Frankie's dancing life remained in the past, until the late 80s, when something unexpected happened. Swing dancing started coming back in style. Suddenly, young people wanted to learn how to Lindy Hop. Out of nowhere, Frankie got a call from a young swing enthusiast, hoping for a lesson from a master.
She came on the phone and said, well, are you Frankie Manning, the dancer? And I said, no, I'm Frankie Manning, the postal worker. So she said, but you used to dance, didn't you? So I'd say, Yeah, I used to dance, but I don't dance anymore.
But Erin Stevens was persistent. She persuaded Frankie to teach her some Lindy moves. He taught her well. The word spread. Broadway producers decided to join in the swing revival with a new show called Black and Blue. They invited Frankie Manning to be a choreographer. The show was a smash, and Frankie won a Tony Award.
Oh, it was fantastic. That was one of the highlights of my life.
New fans around the country started organizing lavish parties for Frankie's birthdays.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you.
In 1999, they celebrated his 85th in the ballroom that had turned Frankie and his friends away so many years before, the Roseland.
The management made a little speech saying that we're sorry about what happened, you know, like back in those days.
We wish we could rewrite history at that time, but we cannot. If we had the time to rewrite history, you wouldn't have been in our dance floor in 1936. We could have done it that way. Tonight, on this occasion, the significant birthday of yours, we are commemorating the enormous contributions that you have made to dance and are placing your shoes in the display alongside those of other greats like Fred Astaire, Savion Glover, Gregory Hines.
I said, oh, wow.
The demand for Frankie Manning's swing dance workshops grew.
All right.
I want them to feel the music as much as I feel it, you know? And I mean, if they feel it half as much, then I'm satisfied.
For the past 20 years, Frankie had regular gigs teaching all over Europe.
Take the left hand here. And then you're going to.
A shake.
Mess around.
And Asia.
Shim sham, shake it up now.
A lot of times they don't understand me, I don't understand them as far as speaking is concerned, but they can understand when my feet move and say, oh, that? Yeah, I can do that.
As much as they loved his teaching, his students seemed to get the biggest thrill from watching Frankie dance, especially to his favorite song, Count Basie's Shiny Stockings.
It's just a groovy, swinging song, baby. Don't. Dun 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 dun.
After a lifetime of dancing with some of the most talented, glamorous women in the business, Frankie's favorite partner in later years was a very different sort.
Chaz is just a wonderful person, and he just happens to be my son.
Heard mom was a kid about 3:30. My daddy said, son, come here to me.
Frankie worked to make up for the time he missed when Chaz was a boy. They traveled the world together, dancing side by side.
It's a thrill. It's such a wonderful time when him and I are on stage together doing Taint What You Do the Way That You Do It. And I just glance over at him and he'd be just wailing. And it just makes me feel so good that he's just still having such a wonderful time dancing.
Everyone says the same thing. He's some kind of a miracle worker. This thing, this longevity, no one ever dreamed of anything like this. I'm glad I can stand up sometimes and he's dancing.
Come on, spread it out. I know all you women are anxious.
The women all lined up to dance with Frankie. On his 80th birthday, he danced with 80 women. On his 85th, with 85.
They had a whole group of young girls, and he would dance with each one for maybe 10 or 20 seconds. And as one left, another one would come in and just kept going. It was endless. I said to myself, he's got to drop dead any minute. He thought that I would join the young girls and then he could dance with me. He didn't imagine that anyone 85 years old wasn't still doing the Lindy Hop.
The idea of slowing down just never interested Frankie very much.
I've had a hip replacement, yeah, and I had knee surgery, so we won't expound on all the things that's wrong with me.
If I said to you that he does at least maybe 40 weekends a year at his age, that is phenomenal.
Thank you.
He's still in demand.
Just before this film was completed, Frankie caught pneumonia. He died as thousands of fans were preparing to gather in New York for his 95th birthday. After a career on the dance floor spanning 8 decades, Frankie Manning was swinging till the end.
I stopped dancing when my feet don't move anymore. And then I might just sit in a chair and try to do that. If you want to live to be a long time, Lindy Hop. Because I'm still doing it, man. Hey, Ruthie, baby.
Come, I just paid you so many compliments, you have to say thank you.
Hi, darling.
Good to see you.
Well, it's good to see you.
I told them you're amazing, and you are. I understand
you look as beautiful as ever.
Singapore. Oh, my God, Frankie.
Yeah, I just came back from Singapore.
Frankie, how do you do it? I'm lucky if I wake up in the morning.
Well, listen, when you wake up in the morning, at least you know you're still here.
That's right.
This program was produced with the generous support of Buddy Steves and Rowena Young, the Houston Swing Dance Society, and Myron Steves Insurance Solutions.